Made in Germany. It's a seal of approval, an assurance of quality. You see, when it comes to precision engineering, few, maybe nobody does it better than the Germans do. And as we saw for ourselves during our frequent visits to Germany, it isn't just cutting-edge technology that gives them an advantage, but smart design and traditional hand craftsmanship as well. So join us as we show you how some of the best German products are made, some of them by hand. I'm David Celdran, and this is Executive Class. Football has been called the beautiful game. And for anyone who's seen or been to a World Cup finals match, it definitely is. But the game Americans call soccer is much more than a display of skill. The world's most popular sport is like a mirror into the soul of the nations obsessed with the game. For Brazil, it's a reflection of the South American country's exuberance. For Argentina, and especially its top player Lionel Messi, football is a showcase of Latin flair. As for the German team that beat both Brazil and Argentina to win the recent World Cup, it's about precision. Logical, systematic, high-quality play that has made them the top team in the world today. Qualities not unlike those that describe German manufacturing. Qualities you immediately recognize in a German car. Our tour of German manufacturing expertise begins in the Bavarian capital, Munich. It's no coincidence, perhaps, that this is the home of Bayern Munich, the top team in the country's Bundesliga. It's also the home of BMW, Bavarian Motor Works. The German company's imposing headquarters, factory, and museum complex is one of the most popular attractions in the city. It's here where you can experience firsthand German engineering history and design excellence. From sports cars to luxury sedans, BMW automobiles have a reputation for spirited driving, a feeling of joy. It's an emotional experience, yes, but one that could only have been produced by a very systematic and scientific approach to making cars and engines. Very German indeed. The Bavarian region also claims another premium German automobile brand, Audi. In Ingolstadt, where the Audi Forum stands, was where the company was established. Back then, a conglomerate of four brands under the name Auto Union. Like the inventor of the modern motor car, Daimler-Benz, Auto Union proved that German cars were more than just about utility. Race cars like these Silver Arrows beat the fancier marks from the UK and Italy, kicking off Germany's reputation for building cars that were also fast and fun. Audi most especially, because not too long ago the brand was seen as too conservative and safe. But with their all-wheel drive quattro cars dominating rallies and Le Mans championships, Audi cars today are the perfect example of how cerebral German design and technology can unleash heart-stopping emotions in the showroom and on the road. If your image of German engineering is of factories of robots, the R8 workshop in Neckarsulm will change that thinking. You'll find machines, yes, but mostly people too, craftsmen even, assembling key parts of the car by hand. Human hands are involved from start to finish, 8 days in all to produce a single sports car. North from Neckarsulm is Stuttgart, which Mercedes-Benz and Porsche call their home. The Porsche Museum is a must-see, even if you don't like cars. The Germans have been wrongly accused of being boring. You'll realize this mistake once you set your eyes on a Porsche car here. Apart from the German Volkswagen Beetle, Porsches have the most recognizable designs in the world. That's because the blueprint for both cars were designed by the same man, Ferdinand Porsche. The Porsches in the museum span more than a half century. but you wouldn't notice it. The designs are timeless, and for the 911, iconic. Driving a design icon is part of the thrill of owning a Porsche, but so is experience technology at its best. Porsche is one of very few manufacturers that can design and build complex roof systems in-house. And the new retractable top of the 911 Targa is absolutely genius. The fully automatic roof system retracts and disappears behind the rear seats in spectacular fashion. Spectacular too is what's under the hood. Engine and suspension technology at the leading edge of the industry. Smart but also human engineering that produces products that are practical as much as they are emotional. Automobiles aren't the only things the Germans do best. Their optical instruments are also legendary, and German cameras in particular. Sure, the Japanese may dominate market share, but ask most professional and serious photographers, and they'll point you to a particular camera brand. We were in Germany recently to visit Leica Camera's new headquarters in Wetzlar to find out why. For Leica, it's like coming home. It was in the Lights workshop in the German city of Wetzlar exactly 100 years ago where Leica's first 35mm camera was introduced. Tiny for its time, the camera invented by Oskar Barnack in 1914 was nicknamed Lilliput because of its size. It was the first to use a small format 35mm film, the template for Leica cameras to come. A small camera, but with a huge impact on photography it turned out to be. These iconic images taken by Leica photographers have changed the world and the way we see it. Images by legends like Henri Cartier-Bresson, Robert Capa, Alfred Eisenstadt. Decisive, explosive moments captured on film using a Leica. Before, the Leica photographers worked with large cameras mounted on heavy tripods. The compact camera using high-resolution film changed all that. With the early 35mm cameras, Leica ushered in a new era in photography. Photojournalism and street photography was born. At the new Lightspark in Wetzlar, these images remind us of the power of photography. In the hands of photojournalists like Magnum's Elliot Erwitt, we started seeing the world in a new perspective. You might recognize some of his work. It's still hard to believe how tools like these have influenced our lives, even changed whole societies. These are some of the milestones of Leica. Cameras that have captured the iconic images that have made us laugh and weep, moved us to anger or action. None more so than the Leica M series of rangefinders. The portable and rugged camera was a perfect companion of photojournalists. The silent shutter release and unobtrusive camera was ideal for capturing fleeting moments. Leica still manufactures analog cameras, but the future is digital. The technology has changed, but the principle stays the same. Compact cameras that produce large images. Leica offers a range of digital cameras from entry-level point-and-shoots to prosumer cameras. The medium-format SLR Leica S is targeted at editorial and fashion photographers, while the digital Leica M is still the tool of choice of photojournalists and enthusiasts of the brand. For professionals like Peter Churnley, who have traded in their analog Leicas for the latest digital Leica M, it's still much the same for them. Compact camera, big sensor, compelling photographs. The Leica M's full-frame sensor works perfectly even with the older M lenses, the ultimate tool for street photography. At the new Lightspark, visitors get a glimpse of how these digital cameras are made. With precision tools and computer technology, of course, but just like with their analog cameras, with human hands. Leica is proud of its German engineering heritage, but just as much as they are about German hand craftsmanship. The newly released all-aluminum body Leica T is proudly handmade in Germany. Leica is also revered for its line of lenses. So incredibly sharp and accurate, they cost even more than a camera body. For visitors at the Light Spark, however, technology takes a backseat to creativity. Art takes center stage, and images over cameras. The new building in Wetzlar doubles as a gallery space featuring the works of legends and promising Leica photographers. Leica is committed to developing young talent and exhibits their works in Leica galleries all over the world. Although Leica cameras are exceptionally designed, for the company, it's not just eye candy, but a tool to capture beauty. Even at the Leica store, of all places, art trumps commerce. Its retail space, a third space after home and workplace, designed for enthusiasts and amateurs to meet and share ideas and photographs. Sure, the store offers the latest cameras and accessories, but photography lessons too. The Leica Academy is open to beginners and professionals and hopes to deepen appreciation for the rich culture of photography. Indeed, for Leica, as it is for German car companies, engineering is much more than just about manufacturing quality. It's just as much about celebrating our humanity. When executive class returns, we continue our tour of Germany with a visit to the Steinway & Sons workshop in the northern city of Hamburg, before heading east to Saxony for a look at traditional German watchmaking in the 21st century. Hamburg is Germany's second largest city. Located on the Elbe River in the north of Germany, Hamburg, since medieval times, has been an important port city. With an extensive network of canals and bridges, Hamburg is often called the Venice of Germany. But instead of palazzos and cathedrals, warehouses line the waterways of the city. It's a reminder of Hamburg's role in the German economy. Its shipping magnates and merchant families have turned the city into one of the richest in the country. Wealthy and sophisticated Hamburg is also a cultured city, with an art scene that counts among the best in Europe. Classical music is central to German culture. The composer Johannes Brahms was born in Hamburg. He joins a long list of legendary German composers: Bach, Handel, Beethoven, Mendelssohn, Schubert, and Schumann. Few know classical music better than the German people. None make piano instruments better than one company based here. The story of Steinway & Sons began in Germany. In 1825, the German Heinrich Steinweg built his first piano. After migrating with his family to New York, he later changed his name to Henry Steinway and his company to Steinway & Sons. The company kept two factories, one in New York, the other in Hamburg. Steinway's motto was simple: to build the best piano possible. No one doubts they do. Their upright and grand pianos are preferred by more than 90% of concert pianists and artists today. There are more than 1,500 Steinway artists. Their autographed photos fill the halls of the company headquarters in Hamburg. Legends like Arthur Rubinstein, Martha Argerich, Vladimir Ashkenazi, and Daniel Barenboim. Filipina Ceci Licat is a Steinway artist too. As is the Chinese prodigy Lang Lang. Jazz and pop musicians count among them. The late Michel Legrand was a fan. So is Billy Joel and Diana Krall.
The look of love is in your eyes.
I think what makes the Steinway the one and only piano for artists is that it offers everything an artist wants. You know, an artist wants to have a piano where he can express himself. So he doesn't want to be limited by the instrument itself, and he want to be inspired. He want to see opportunities in a piano which follows his ideas of interpretation of the composer.
A piano that conforms to the artist, not the other way around. That's how every Steinway is made.
One of our philosophies is that we think it is played by a human being and by hands, so we should also manufacture it in the same way. So we don't do anything like handmade by robots or something like that. But what it means is that we listen into the piano and decide what we can make out of it. Every Steinway is very individual. There's not one sounding like the other. This is not a differentiation in quality, it's just in the differentiation in soul, in sound and touch.
No two Steinway pianos are the same, because each one is handmade. It takes up to a year to construct a single grand piano. It begins with sourcing the best wood possible. Hardwoods like cherry and spruce are ideal. For limited edition and custom-made pianos, exotic woods are used as veneers. All pieces are carefully selected and uniformly cut and stored in the Hamburg workshop. Wood is dried and matured for up to 2 years here. It's the only way to control quality and produce the unique character Steinways are known for. Steinway & Sons developed 126 patents over the years. One of the most critical is the one-piece continuous bent rim that forms a grand piano case. The design and technology hasn't changed much since 1878. The rim is made from 18 layers of hard maple wood, painstakingly glued to each other and made to dry. The inner and outer rims are pressed together in a single, precise, and hand-driven operation using Steinway's patented machinery and team of experienced craftsmen. The most experienced artisans craft the soundboard. It's the soul of the piano, the heart from which the music is amplified. Another team of artisans constructs the bridges that transmit sound from the strings to the soundboard. Up to 85% of the piano is constructed by hand, using over 300 people to assemble 12,000 individual parts. In every corner, you'll find him working almost exclusively with her hands. The remaining 15% requires computer or heavy machinery to make. The cast iron plate weighs up to 150 kilograms. It absorbs the force pianists apply to the instrument, as much as 20 tons of tension on the strings. Tweaking and toning the instrument is another critical phase of production. Golden ears and feather-light touch are needed to detect problems and fix inconsistencies. The tone of the music, the touch of the keys, the reflex action, it's all tested and adjusted to perfection here. When fully assembled, the pianos get their finishing touch, rich black varnish polished to a high gloss. Special colors and customized veneers are also possible. The limited edition Dakota Jackson Arabesque is among the most elegant grand pianos they make. Handcraftsmanship like this doesn't come cheap. The retail price of a Steinway in Germany ranges from 30,000 to upwards of 136,000 euro for basic black. Much more for a special color or custom design. Precious handmade instruments are a passion in the German state of Saxony as well. In the royal capital, Dresden, most especially. The Saxon monarchs were avid collectors of musical instruments and mechanical timepieces. The Saxon kings are long gone, but the watchmaking industry they helped develop in the 19th century still thrives in the small city of Glashütte today. Glashütte was once a poor town of Saxony, but its rich mines attracted jewelers and watchmakers to the area. One of the pioneers to set up shop was Ferdinand A. Lange, founder of the watch company A. Lange & Söhne. Glashütte was also where the German watchmaking school was established, a center of excellence designed to rival the Swiss. It's now the German Watch Museum, a fitting tribute to an industry that in its heyday produced pocket watches prized for their accuracy and unique aesthetic beauty. The intricately decorated cases and the visible movements with the engraved three-quarters plate became the trademark of Glashütte watches, a trademark that survives to this day. There are many reasons why German brands were eclipsed by the Swiss, but mostly because of the demise of the industry after Germany's defeat in World War II. But after the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989, German watch brands experienced a rebirth, with A. Lange & Söhne leading the revival. For A. Lange & Söhne, that meant reviving its traditional approach to watchmaking. All their watches are still made by hand in Glashütte, from start to finish. The brand icon, the Lange 1, is one of the most awarded watches in modern history, and the rest of the model range testify to the unique German approach to design. Form follows function. Clean watch faces with outsized numerals that tell the time and date clearly.
This is one of the perks of being invited to SIHH. It's the chance to hold watchmaking history in your hands, or rather on your wrist. The Terra Luna is not just a technical masterpiece, it's a piece of poetry.
For their new collection, unveiled at SIHH in Geneva early this year, A. Lange & Söhne shows us how to craft watches of startling beauty without having to resort to gimmickry. The German watchmaker was in Manila recently, part of a tour of the region to give customers and journalists a chance to experience German watchmaking tradition firsthand.
Yeah, Lange is very unique because we put in a lot of time and effort into the handcraftsmanship, so the polishing and finishing of all the parts. If you look into our movements, all the parts are finished, which means if you were to disassemble a movement and look on the underside of the parts, no surface is left unfinished. And of course, this is time-consuming, and it takes a lot of expertise.
The attention to detail, the commitment to innovation, and the passion for precision. These are values you find in each A. Lange & Söhne timepiece. Values you also appreciate in every Steinway & Sons piano, a Leica camera, or Porsche sports car. Be it on the field or in the showroom, pursuit of perfection is apparently what Germans enjoy the most.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Celdran. Thanks for watching.